Thank you so much for the introduction, and not only for the introduction, but also for all your kind emails and support in organizing of this meeting. I really appreciate it. Anyway, now I need to figure out, I guess, yes. Hello, everyone. I really appreciate again this opportunity to talk in front of you. I wish we can talk in person, and I hope someday when life will be back to normal, I can meet you again in person, and we can usually, after this kind of outreach, we have SBIR staff, we have a long line for one-on-ones. This is different line life, but let's hope that I will be able to provide some information. Today, I'm going to talk about NIH SBIR STTR program and also a small business program at National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases. Just to remind you, SBIR program, Small Business Innovation Research, STTR program, Small Business Technology Transfer. Both programs set aside. What this means, it's basically each federal agency with budget more than 100 million must participate in SBIR program and set aside 3.2% from their extramural budget. For STTR program, agencies with budget more than $1 billion by law must set aside 0.45%. And the best part of this, this money can be used only to support small business program. I'm very happy about this because, you know, this money can go only to support my program. Yes. Anyway, during this presentation, it's not enough time to talk in details about this program, but I would like really to point you at SBIR NIH site, especially for those who are new to the program. Click on the yellow button, new to SBIR, go to infographic, and it will tell you each step, what needs to be done, registration, what solicitation to use, how to apply. Dig more during this website. I really love frequently asked questions. Sometimes I'm actually looking myself when I forgot something. Again, look through this website, very helpful, especially for those who never applied and don't have enough knowledge, you know, about the programs. But when I mention these two programs, keep in mind, what's the major difference, critical difference between this program? For SBIR, we always encourage to have collaboration with research institution. For STTR, you must have a collaborator. For SBIR, outsource percentage. Small business needs, the work needs to be done at small business 37%, but 33% for phase one, you can outsource. For phase two, 50%. For STTR, from this point, the program a little bit more flexible because minimum work requirement, 40% by small business, 30% by research institution, but the rest 30%, you can move around. It means you can do, for example, 70% at small business. Again, it's a little bit more flexible from this point. And another one more major critical difference, it's principal investigator. For SBIR, primary employment must be more than 50% within the small business. For STTR, PI may be employed by research institution or by small business. But keep in mind that award always made to the small business. Small business apply and get an award. I'm sure you will see this slide today, or maybe you saw it before, but just to remind you that NIH from 27, 24 institutes are participating in small business program. And actually the money are quite big. It's more than $1 billion at NIH. It's a big amount of money. NIAID, our institute, is the largest institute within NIH, and CI National Council is the largest one with the second largest institute. And our budget for fiscal year 2020, 175 million. Again, most of this money goes to support a small business program within NIAID. I'm getting this question sometimes. Applicants want to know what's the advantage, why to apply for small business program. Provide seed funding for innovative technology. It's not a loan. You will get money. You don't need to repay back. And it doesn't impact stocks or shares at any way. Intellectual property rights retained by small business. and of course provide recognition, verification, and visibility. Every year in normal life, we will set up small business workshop all over US for NIAID, and I will invite investors, and quite often during their presentation, they will say that it's a big advantage when somebody approaching them and having successful awarded small business grants. Again, just very quickly about the program structure, three phases. Phase one, visibility, proof of principle. Phase two, development, research and development. And phase three, non-federal money, commercialization stage. But I want to point that I put there some grant mechanism. I'm going to talk on my next slides about this. Direct to phase two available, fast track application, phase 2B, and commercialization readiness program. And I will talk about this again, as I said, on my next slides. For example, fast track. Fast track is a very nice, actually, mechanism. When you will submit phase one, phase two in one package, like one package application, it will go to the review, it will get one score. The advantage of this mechanism, you can get funding for phase two significantly faster. For example, you will finish phase one, you will write progress report, your program officer approve it, and you can get funding maybe for phase two, maybe in a couple of weeks later, which is great. Because normally you will need to apply for phase one, wait if you are awarded or not, submit application again, wait another 8 months to know if you are awarded or not. But be careful with fast track, because you need to be sure that you have a really strong commercialization plan. Sometimes reviews, when they will look at the whole package, they don't know if the phase one is going to be successful or not. And therefore, again, it's a great mechanism. Just be a little bit careful if you have enough data and you can write a good, strong phase two application with strong commercialization plan. And on my few slides later, I will show you success rates for each grant mechanism. Now, phase 2B, another wonderful mechanism for phase two grantees. It's basically when you finish your phase two and you're looking for additional time and additional funding, some institutes, not all, some actually allowed you to apply to phase 2B. And the good part about our institute, you don't need matching funds from investors. It's basically additional time and additional budget, again, if needed for your research. On my next few slides, I will be talking about budget, but just to let you know, for phase 2B, you can request $1 million per year up to 3 years. Again, it's for us, for my institute. If you are going to apply to another NIH institute, you need to talk to program officials to get what's their numbers. Now, I mentioned direct to phase 2 program. NIH used to have a separate program announcements. Now, if you decided to go with this grant mechanism, you can just apply to Omnibus, and direct to phase two, it's allowed. You can apply through Omnibus solicitation. Basically, it's for small business who already generate certain data, and they can bypass phase one and apply directly to phase two. Keep in mind, it's only SBIR mechanism. We do not have direct to phase two for STTR, only SBIR. And it's not available for CDC, FDA, and some other federal agencies. Again, as I mentioned, NIH is not going to reissue another separate program announcement. You need to apply through Omnibus. Now, let's talk about a commercialization readiness pilot program. It's another great funding opportunities for phase two and phase 2B. At NIH, we have three of them, actually. Two large ones, technical assistance and late-stage development, clinical trials not allowed. And similar, but clinical trials allowed. We, as NIH, are participating only in clinical trials not allowed. And there is the third one, the smaller one, just technical assistance. Again, if you're considering this program announcement, talk to program officials from another institute if you're going to apply to another institute. And on this slide, a little bit more details about this program. It's different from phase 2B because it's allowed you some activities. Phase 2B, as I mentioned, it's continuation of your research and development. This, you can see a list of activities allowed for this program announcement. The best part of this, what I like about this program announcement, as I mentioned, for phase two, you can outsource only 50%. For CRP, you can, there is not no even percentage in the solicitation. You basically cannot outsource quite a bit. Of course, it's still small business need to do some work, but you can outsource maybe 80%. Again, it's a nice opportunity because usually policy is very strict for phase twos. You can outsource only 50%. Just to remind what I mentioned, the difference between phase 2B versus CRP, phase 2B after phase two award, again, 50% only outsource. Some institutes encourage matching funds, funding, not us. Again, you can apply through Omnibus. CRP, as I mentioned, separate solicitation, we have three of them, and it can be for grantees after, during phase two or after phase two or phase 2B, okay? Now, I mentioned Omnibus solicitation. It's a parent solicitation at NIH. About 80% of applicants actually applying to Omnibus. We have three receipt dates, but please remember about targeted solicitation. Check ICs, institutes you want to apply because they have targeted. And success rate usually it's higher because less applicants applying to targeted. Just again, as I said, keep in mind, not just Omnibus. Check mission and what available within each institute. But on the top of this, we also have contract solicitation. About 20% of applicants applying for contracts, not all ICs. I believe we have only five ICs who have contract solicitation. It's a targeted solicitation, receipt day only once a year. And I think I have one more slide. No, okay, let's go. I will talk a little bit more about contracts later. Okay, this is Omnibus. I mentioned Omnibus. At NIH, we have four Omnibus grant solicitation right now. Two of the SBIRs and two STTR. Two of them clinical trials allowed and two clinical trials are not allowed. Again, NIAID are participating only in SBIR and STTR, clinical trials not allowed. Again, if your project related to clinical trials, NIAID, we are not participating in Omnibus, but we have a wonderful actually program announcement. Keep in mind, again, if your project related to clinical trials, we have so-called, it's our targeted U44 clinical trials required solicitation. U44 program supports implementation of clinical trials from small businesses that propose clinical trials in the research area within mission of our institute. Today's January 13, actually tomorrow, this program announcement is expired, but it's going to be reissued a new one. And in a new one, the grant mechanism as direct to phase two and phase 2B are allowed. And therefore watch, read more, read notice below link and also question and answers. I also highly recommend to, if you can, to apply. Success rate is definitely higher. We're not getting a lot of applicants because it's not easy for small businesses to be on this level, on the level of clinical trials. Again, if you can, I highly recommend to read this solicitation. Now, I mentioned contract solicitation once a year. The one solicitation for 2021, it's closed already, but we are going to have, I believe it's going to be in July. We are going to open a new one. For 2022, we are going to have 16 contract topics. Just to let you know, for those who are not familiar, what's the difference between grants and contracts? Grants, you will write your specific aims and you will apply, you will get award. It's your, you will get money and you will do your research. With contracts, basically, institute is telling you what we, government, would like you to do. It's very targeted, very specific tasks. And again, if you feel that you actually can do it, again, I highly recommend you to apply because again, success rate is higher, we have less applicants. Again, if you can, check and apply sometimes in July. And closing will be also at the end of October of 2021, yeah. Okay, now about the program, important fact to remember, You will apply, all eligibility will be checked at the time of the award. Grant management at the time, if you will get awarded, will check all eligibility. Principal investigator is not required to have a PhD or MD, but required to have expertise to oversee the project. Also, principal investigator is not required to have US citizenship, but must legally reside in United States and must be available to perform the research proposed for the duration of the project. Keep in mind that you can submit your application to different agencies. You can submit, for example, phase one, you apply to NSF, and phase two, you would like to apply to us, NIH. What you will need to do in this case, reach out to people, program officials like me, and I will connect and provide information what needed, but it's allowed. Also, you can switch if you apply to phase one SBIR and you want to apply to phase two to STTR and vice, and you know, you can do it. Now it's allowed too. Keep in mind, if you want to submit two applications to different agencies, which is allowed for similar work, but you're not going to get award twice, only once, unfortunately. Yeah. I put this busy slide just for you because I'm getting so many questions about this. In red, this is the stage when and with whom you can talk. When you submit your application, it will go to NIH, it will go to Central Scientific Review, to referral office, and they will assign your application. But before you will submit, you can say you have idea, you can talk to us, to program staff. Then check eligibility. You can also can talk to us, or you can reach out to SBA, or we can help you to reach out to SBA if there is some concern about eligibility. When you submit, we cannot help you. You need, and there is some issues, for example, you can talk only to aragrants.gov or help desk. Again, after submission, referral office, we cannot do anything. And then during scientific review, only scientific review officer can talk to you. We cannot also help. But after the review, you will get your summary statement document, the document where all information will be about review, weaknesses, strong points, each reviewer's comment. You can reach out to your program officer assigned to your application and talk to them. And basically, yes, then it's up to us. ICs, discussion, budget, and you know when you're going to be awarded. Next slide, just to give you idea, submission dates. For example, September 5th, you will submit it. You can get award sometimes in March. January 5th, sometimes award will be sometimes in July. And your submission April 5th, award can be September or December. Yeah. Now let's talk about our institute. Mission of our institute. NIAID, conduct and support basic and applied research to better understand, treat, and prevent infection, immunological and allergic diseases. And we also have unique mandate. I'm sure all of you heard Dr. Fauci, director of our institute. Our second unique mandate required our institute to respond to emerging public health threats. It was the same with Ebola, Zika, now obviously coronavirus. Yeah. Within our institute, we have four extramural divisions. And the first three divisions are all divisions are very important, but for you guys from the point of submission, division of AIDS, division of allergy, immunology and transportation date, division of microbiology, infection diseases. Budget, almost all budget of these divisions goes to support contracts, grants and cooperative agreements. Division of extramural activities is basically division where policies, grant management, acquisition, and small business also under this division. And on the next few slides, I'm going to go very quickly, sorry about because not a lot of time, areas of high interest for each division. And below I put a link where you can read more. And I want, before I will quickly go through this, I want to point why it's actually important, because I mentioned you will submit your application, Office of the Referral will assign your application. But I always will, when I talk to applicants, I will say, please know the areas of high priorities and target your application. We have a published pay line within my institute. 2020, it was 34 for SBIR, 34 for STTR. If you within pay line, if you got 34 and below, you will get your funding, no question asked. But for example, You got a good score, but it's above pay line. If division really like your ideas, your technology, your application, there is a ways to support. Quite often at the end of the year, we have some money left and we create so-called end of year list. Again, it will help if you know what division or institute is looking, okay? Now, going back to the division of AIDS, basically the mission is to help ensure the end of HIV epidemics by increasing understanding of pathogenesis and transmission of human of HIV, supporting the development of therapies for HIV infection, develop new therapeutic and vaccine targets, stimulate research towards a cure HIV. And below again, as I said, there is a link. There is the same kind of slide for a division of allergy, immunology, and transportation date. Below, you can see a link for high priorities. And mission of this division to understand the immune system, how it functions in maintaining health and its role in numerous diseases. And this division encourage application under topics asthma allergies, autoimmune disease, immune system, radiation exposure, transplantation. And division of microbiology infection diseases. This is the largest division with more than 300 targets. And you can imagine with COVID, it's overwhelmed with request emails. And at the end, you will see also link to the area of high priority. Next couple of slides I put together related to COVID. Unfortunately, at this moment, we do not have program solicitation related to COVID and small business. After September 5th, our institute and most actually NIH Institute decided to expire COVID-19 SBIR STTR notice of special interest, so-called NOSIS, and direct all on mission COVID applications through Omnibus. But I put a link, I really advise you to check sometimes because maybe it will be some changes. And I noticed there's a couple of notice. Not small business, but eligibility small businesses can apply. Again, just take a look. And for your information, I put a slide about available resources within NIAID. Couple of links. You can see that Biodefense Emerging Infection Research Repository, BEI, resources are available at this link. And I believe some of them actually are free. Check, you will see point of contact. If you have additional questions, you can reach out to them. On these slides, I want to talk about success rate. For phase one SBIR STTR, it's about 20%. Fast track, a little bit higher, 24-18% for both for programs. Phase two around 2%, phase two around 40%. Direct to phase two, 12%. Each year, it's actually there's some variation. Couple of years ago, direct to phase two, it was on the level of phase one. And phase 2B is always about 40-50% success rate. Now, let's talk about money because I'm getting a lot of questions about this, but these numbers, especially numbers for within the waiver topic, specifically for NIAID. SBA, they actually increase hard caps recently. From SBA information, for phase one, 259,000, phase two, 1.7 million. But NIH received a waiver from Small Business Administration. What this means, it's a list of research topics and SBA approved these research topics for each institute. And you can find research approved research topics in this, this link provided. But within NIAID, on purpose, our research topics are very broad. And for NIAID, for phase one, we will allow up to 300,000 per year, up to 2 years. Again, you can actually get up to 600, up to 2 years. And phase two, 1 million per year, up to 3 years. You don't need additional approvals. I'm getting quite a bit of emails. Can I get approval for amount within the waiver? No. But grant management will check at the time of the award. What you need to be sure and be careful, you need to be sure that your application match the budget request. Again, you don't, the best not to get the sentence from reviewers that applicants requesting a lot of money they don't need for their research. The best if you will see this sentence, keep the budget as requested. Again, reviewers are going to evaluate your application based on scientific merit, not on budget. But again, you need to be sure that you're requesting higher budget and you need that your science match your request. Yes, I think I mentioned this. Now, also keep in mind that now you can request actually for phase one up to 6,500 for technical assistance in your application. And this 6,500 for phase one per year. For phase two, you can request 50,000 for the life of the project. And this is in addition to the amount of the award. Again, phase one, 6,500, phase two, 50,000. And just brief description how you can use it. If you decided to go and request technical assistance, please request within application, request in F other direct cost lines, and include a detailed description of what kind of technical and business assistance your vendor will provide. Okay. Now, a few slides I just want to put together, just I hope it will help you. First of all, keep in mind, always talk to us. I'm surprised to hear quite often that sometimes applicants think they can talk to us only after they will apply. No, I'm getting a lot of emails. I have a group of people, I will show you the slide at the end. We setting calls quite often. We reply on the emails quite often. What I'm saying, it's better to talk and don't request a call 2 days before the submission days. Talk to us before and we will guide you and we will connect you with a subject matter expert from the division and you can discuss your scientific specific aims. I put a link for a list NIH and agency, each instant contact website, then you can see my name. I always please, if you decided to reach out, include a small abstract, half a paragraph, non-confidential. Just I will see if it's within the mission of our institute or I can guide you and tell you where your application can go. And as I mentioned, please submit earlier, not days, not minutes. We're the only institute who posted samples of successful application. I'm very proud of this project. It was not easy. Again, there is a link. We have phase one, phase two. It's examples of applicants who got awarded. Just give you idea if you're first time applying to the program. Now, we also establish application assistant program. Some institutes also running similar program, but NIAID is a little bit different. For us, our application assistant program for awarded phase ones or for fast track applicants or direct to phase two applicants. And the second, it's the program 3 cycles. The second cycle just open and we already, actually applicants, we will open, it will fill, slots will fill in half a day. But the next one, the third cycle is going to be early April. Please watch, subscribe to our SURF link and you will get information. I really advise you, it's no cost program, just to support you, to help you how to apply and be successful. On this slide, I put key documents. The reason why I put it, because please read it. SF-424 guide, omnibus solicitation, please read it, grant policy statement links, annotated form sets, and online tutorials. Again, it can be very helpful. Now, I'm sure some of them familiar, maybe not, NIH reporter. Use this site because you can actually, it's a searchable database for funded application. You can put the keywords in the search box and see institutes applicants apply. You can read abstracts. You can see program officials who are connected to this application. There's also matchmaker function. You can actually put the whole paragraph to do the search. And if you will go to detail tab, you can actually get information about who is a program, again, as I said, program officials on this grant. It also can help you maybe to see if you're missing information about who is your competition for your project. It's always important. I always say for phase ones, you don't need to write commercialization plan, but please keep in mind that you need to address potential for commercialization in your application, maybe a couple of sentences. Now, the same idea use federal reporter. I believe it's about maybe 17 federal agencies, and now it's even more, maybe more than a million projects. Do the search and you can see again similar projects. When you decided to apply, you can use optional form. This form reviews are not going to see, but you can request institute assignment. For example, you decided to go with us, but you also can request additional two institutes, so-called dual assignment. The reason, because sometimes science can be overlapped, like us, for example, and another institute. The reason why I'm saying this, again, you have a good score, it's above pay line. Program officials like me can talk to another institute and ask if they have money left, can they fund your application? Again, you will kind of increase your chance to be funded. Also, you can request study session assignment. You can actually mention if you have any conflict, and you can suggest expertise. You cannot recommend reviewers. I really advise you actually to use this form. And for your information, because it's different now, it used to be all this information you can put in cover letter. Now in cover letter, you can use only to explain why the application is late. Be careful, try to avoid this. You can put a notice of plan to submit a video, and you can also information that you're generating large scale genomic data. And as I mentioned, cover letter cannot be used to make assignment or suggest specific reviews. This tool is very nice. It can help you to give you advice what study session to use, because I'm getting these questions a lot. The best actually to talk if you know your program officer. It's for those who already applied. These program officers can recommend, but in this tool, you can use not just SBIR, you can select SBIR or another grant mechanism, then put short paragraph or title of your application, click search, and it will recommend you 3-4 study sessions. Very helpful. Now, I'm done, long talk. Anyway, and at the end, I just want to share the slides. This is my team, because if you will reach out, maybe you will see not just my name, because I will forward, I have so many requests I will forward. It's Adam Zorkin, he's a senior small business development specialist. Hajel English, small business developer, and the rest also of guys, Patricia Ross and Kenneth Kim, small business development specialist. Great team, very knowledgeable, always happy to help. And I'm done. Okay.
So we actually have a bunch of questions I see from the audience. Do you want to go through them? Would you like me to read them out for you?
If it's okay, can you read it? Because I still
Sure. Okay. No problem. So the first question is, since SBIR requires 50% work done by small business, does that mean virtual small businesses are not eligible for SBIR funds?
Let's put this again, phase two, 50%. About virtual, it's a little bit, always a little bit trickier. I cannot see the name, but please send me email with a little bit more information about your virtual situation and let me look into this, because again, it's always a little bit trickier. And it's not just us, grant management. I need to consult with our grant management if it's eligible or not, okay?
Okay. Our next question is, are small businesses who get all their work outsourced to third parties not eligible for STTR?
No. Okay, because again, STTR phase, as I mentioned, phase one, 40% small business, phase two, 50%. You cannot change these numbers. And only program announcement, commercialization readiness program, when you can outsource more than 50, maybe 70, maybe 80, maybe 90, but still some work needs to be done by small business.
Okay. The next question, there are a few.
Okay, sure.
No, it's great. This is great. Do you need a matching VC fund for a CRP program?
No.
Okay. The next question is, could you please explain that NOSI approach? Does one find a NOSI when applying?
It's a good question because we're confused, very confused. No, sorry. Okay. NOSI, it's basically the way how it works. They will publish this very short description, maybe one page, and they will guide you. They will say you can apply to this NOSI, but in reality, you're still applying to Omnibus, you know what I mean? Through Omnibus or another target or another solicitation. They will, in the NOSI will be information how you need to apply, through what solicitation you're going. But in reality, NOSI, it's same, the document is very short. It's like one page. Again, as you guys can imagine, our institute, National Institute of Allergy, Infection Diseases, and Coronavirus. It's a lot of, but I wish it will be more solicitation related to coronavirus. But as you can imagine, vaccine production is very important. Most of the budget goes there. And again, within Omnibus is very broad. This Omnibus parent solicitation is very broad. And if your project related to coronavirus applies through Omnibus, you can reach out to me, send me a paragraph. I will connect you with Division of Microbiology Infection Diseases and provide you a name of subject matter expert. Again, yeah, this is, unfortunately, this is what how we can help right now.
Okay. So this person wrote that they're a Dutch microneedle company looking to enhance vaccination. Are they eligible to apply at NIAID?
Oh gosh, I wish. Unfortunately, no. Foreign interactions, it's basically this program designed to spend money in US, SBIR STTR money in US. In very rare situations, we will allow it. But usually this kind of request, it kind of goes with a red flag. And again, case-to-case situations, a lot of approvals. My advice, if you can, avoid it. In case if, for example, samples cannot be found here or something like this, then it needs to be very strong justification from both from applicants, from our grant management. Again, case-to-case situation. If you can, better to avoid it.
Okay. The next question, does the company need to provide an industry fund, VC or otherwise, for phase 2B?
No. Again, as I said, for our institute, keep this in mind, like a National Cancer Institute, for example, they will request matching funds. But for us, no. Again, phase 2B, no matching funds, no additional money. It's just continuation. If you need additional time and budget to continue your phase 2. Phase 2. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. So this person wrote, thank you for your presentation. While the current pandemic has highlighted the need for better infection prevention measures globally, earning grant dollars in the infection prevention space has been challenging. Does NIAID have an infection prevention focus? If not, do you think infection prevention will become a priority topic?
Oh, yeah. First of all, thank you. Second of all, it's a very good question. Let's do this way, because again, what I would like, if you can, this person who reach out, send me email and I will connect you with appropriate, I didn't want to have a discussion about this because I'm not the expert, the biggest expert in this area, but I will connect you with appropriate people to discuss from the Division of Microbiology Infection Diseases.
Okay, just to clarify, we can upload this to our blog on FreeMind and we'll send it out to all of our participants.
Will see my email, my contact, yes, again.
Yeah, so that actually answers the next question, who asked for your email again. So this person asked, can any of the work be done outside the US with contract labs such as GLP?
Again, any work outside US, it's basically falls under foreign interactions, I'm afraid. But again, I need to look into a little bit more details into this. Okay. Yeah.
Going back to COVID-19, other than SBIR, STTR, what other sources are available for clinical trials?
For clinical trials, oh gosh. Okay, I feel kind of bad that I'm referral every time to somebody else. Yes, we have a big network within NIAID related to clinical trials. I will need to send a couple of links. I don't have it in my slides because it's not related to SBIR. As I said, for a small business, it's only U44 solicitation. I have a slide about this, but I can send additional information later. I'm sorry, my audience, that I'm saying this, but yeah, my focus was only on SBIRs. Yeah.
Okay. Is the TABA request part of the SBIR application or is it separate? I hope I pronounced that correctly.
It's TABA. TABA. It's technical assistance. Yes, it's within application. And on one of my slides, when I'm talking about TABA, you can see how you can request it. Okay. It's line F, and on the slide, you will see the way it can be requested.
Okay, and I heard about active COVID. For how is that reviewed? Active for COVID, ACTIV, maybe I didn't correct that.
Honestly, not familiar. I don't have information about this, yeah.
Okay. Does anyone else have any other questions before we end the session? It doesn't seem to be. Okay. So thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Kruchinin.
You're very, you're very welcome.
And I like your background.
I hope next year I will see you in person. Thank you so much for your help.
Hopefully.